like to tell you a little bit about Mark. We're very lucky to have him tonight. He, like I said, is a member of the Lucas Funeral Home family. He didn't stay in the business, he left, and as young men are wont to do, traveled around the country and did a lot of different things before he finally decided to come back to the Fort Worth area and get involved in the funeral home again. He graduated from University of Texas at Austin, and then he has just done many, many things, including my profession, teaching school. He taught government and debate and history, and he ended up in radio management, ran some radio stations, and helped build a world-class resort in Utah, and got involved in a student newspaper, ran that in Seattle, Washington, and even tried his hand at acting a little bit. So he has lived in the western United States for quite a while, but we're so glad to have him tonight because the Lucas Funeral Home is a sixth-generation funeral home family, and they have their roots in Grapevine, Texas. It goes all the way back to the 1850s. They've been in Fort Worth since 1929, and they've begun to buy out some other funeral homes. So I'll let him tell you all about that. Please help me welcome Mark Lucas Kelly.
Well, how's everybody feeling?
That
means something when someone in my profession asks you that. And I'll call out, I see an old friend, I'll call him, sitting on the back row here that just joined tonight. I call him out because his family goes back to the founding of Grapevine like mine does back in the day. Hey, Tommy. I guess be a little unorthodox. There'll be Q&A at the end. I'm going to pretty much just depend on a PowerPoint. And can you hear me okay?
Yes.
I know I'm not Mike, but I can usually project. Do you have any questions before I begin? I know this is a profession and a service, really, that a lot of people have a lot of questions about. If they've experienced the loss, then they don't have as many questions. But, you know, many folks haven't had to go and arrange a funeral, or luckily, do any of that. So there's a lot of questions or myths out there I could debunk if you want, or we can just start off here.
Let's start off and have the questions.
All right. And I'm honored to be here. I talk a lot about the genealogy, but I am a cursed to be a procrastinator. So I've only gone back so far on one side of the family, not the Lucas side, to 1705, and you know, to the Lucas's maybe back to 1812 maybe, and the Kellys maybe around that time in the mid-1800s, so I've got a lot of work to do, bow to y'all for doing probably a lot better. I've used this system, so let's see. Oh, good. I shouldn't have worn it. Would y'all mind if it were missed?
It was hot in here.
Hotter than a $2 pistol in here, as they used to say.
Ooh,
I shouldn't have worn this cashmere jacket.
That pistol's $3 now.
So we'll just start off with this. She mentioned different funeral homes. This started all in 1860 out in Grapevine, and I'll get to that in a minute. But as time has progressed, we have purchased other family funeral homes that didn't want to sell to the large corporate funeral homes. So we're in partnership with Robertson Muller Harper here in Fort Worth. That's another fine funeral home. Been in business since 1879. Calvario's on the north side. That's the old Shannon's Funeral Chapel there at Northside Drive in Maine. Blessing is the oldest funeral home out in Mansfield. Fabulous. It used to be a college, a woman's college. It's on the historical registry. It's beautiful. Old place out there in Mansfield. Williams and Lucas is our funeral home that we opened in 1929 on Sylvania. And when the Williams, the oldest African-American funeral service in Fort Worth's place, burnt down over on Ramey, we tried to help them look for a place for years. They were underinsured, had some issues, and so we partnered with them. So I think we're the only white and black funeral home in the United States to have partnered up. I don't have that officially, but I've never heard of it happening before, and it's an unsung story that ought to be told, actually. And Lucas is, we're in, starting Grapevine and Hurst, Keller. We have a couple of small family places down in Brownwood and Comanche and out in Cisco, Eastland, and Strawn, the Edwards family out there. That's kind of our motto. A funeral is not a day in a lifetime, but a lifetime in a day. We feel very strongly that regardless of what religion you are, or if you do not profess a religion, that we should try and celebrate that person's life. And that's not cliche. I'm not being an advertisement for Lucas, so to speak. I would not have come back and gotten into this. Of course, sometimes it's out of our control. It depends on if a family has a preacher or not, or who's speaking. But it's always our hope that they take time, whoever is going to meet with the family, to gain some good stories about that person, their accomplishments, their challenges, the humor. What really was their life? I feel like that's forgotten. We're told all the time we're made in the image of the Lord, but people kind of forget about the person, you know, that's made in that image. And you need to tell their story. That's our main, we have to keep the doors open. We're not free. I wish we were. I wish it was a charity model, to be honest with you. But we've got to keep, satisfy the banker, so to speak. But regardless of that, our really main goal is to try and help guide people when they're in shock and grief to tell their loved one's story. That's more important than anything, any of it. The heritage, of course, that wonderful war that went from 1860 to 1865. But I mean, embalming and preparation of deceased goes back to ancient Egypt. But really, up until this time, where you died, you pretty much laid and stayed there, unless you were royalty or wealthy. Just getting the person back home was a feat and preparation. And I asked my cousin, who knows about everything about funeral directing, I said, what happened in the gap from ancient Egypt up to the 1850s and 60s? And he said, you know, that's a good question. I don't know. So I'm not sure why this disappeared or how that happened. But when this war started, and, of course, this war, y'all, you know, forever we thought we lost 650,000 people. All historians are agreed now that we're getting close to a million. We're in the 900,000s that were lost in that war, not just on the field of battle, ancillary people that were killed. And so people wanted to bring their loved ones home. So that embalming and preparation started, and so there was a need, a greater need, and a lot of it started in people that had furniture stores or general stores because they could provide a pine box or a coffin. And I just took a little liberty there. If you can pretend that's Grapevine without the mountains. So, you know, the community gathered out there. I know, block off the mountains. You know, it was more of a community feat, you know. There wasn't a grave digging business, you know, and the undertaker, which became the funeral director, like my great-great-grandparents, had a general store out there on what was called the Flats or the Estelle area, the south part of where the DFW airport is then. And so they provided a pine box. And I imagine all got together with various ones and helped dig the grave. These are my great-great-grandparents here, Wingate Hezekiah Lucas and Cornelia Dopkins, and my great-uncle Bob, and these are their children. That's their homestead. That was shot 1880. That's in that area down the south part of the DFW airport. His father, Thomas, had fought in the War of 1812, and then came over from Georgia, hit Arkansas in 1852, didn't like it there, I guess, so went down to Dallas in 1853 and had a farm, about a 280-acre farm there, and he had two boys, Wingate and his brother King. King stayed up in Dallas on that farm, and Wingate came down to the Grapevine area and had a much larger farm than that. And so that's kind of where it all started there. And pretty much they operated that general store there till a couple of the boys went downtown into Grapevine in 1889 and got a two-story building that's still there today on Main Street. And forgive me for not having it on this PowerPoint. I've got a couple of pictures in the computer I can show you in a minute. So it was a general store downstairs, and what they referred to as coffins and burial garments upstairs. And at that time, if you passed away, my family went out to the home and performed the embalming there on what was called a cooling board or the gravity bottle. They didn't have electric pumps doing it. And so let's say your grandmother died back then, and she would lay in state there at the house, unless they didn't have room. And then my great-grandparents, later, they had a room in their house in town in Grapevine where people could bring their loved one if they didn't have room. Now, this is all before the 1920s, so that's how kind of things were kind of operating back then. Now, I want to get into another. Y'all probably know this, but the younger generations, because funeral homes stopped the ambulance service about 1966 to 1970, right in that. But before then, from 1900 to 1970, funeral homes were the first responders, right? Your taxes paid for fire and for police. No one forgets. I always say it's kind of like insurance. Why do we have dental insurance regular? Aren't your teeth part of your body? But they were completely separate. Why communities did not see the need for first responders or ambulance calls, I don't know. So funeral homes filled it. It was goodwill. It was advertising. This is out in front of St. Joseph's Hospital. It doesn't exist anymore. That's a doctor with one of the ambulances from Robertson Muller Harper. And we'll walk us on into the 50s. That's a Lucas ambulance on Riverside. And that's my cousin Jim and a fellow there in the 60s, there in the Riverside area. And we'll get on up in the late 60s. That's an ambulance in Hearst that I grew up around. So all you could do then was speed like hell and give oxygen. EMTs didn't exist, you know, yet. That hadn't come into vogue. And the term that doctors use is scoop and run. If y'all remember when Lady died, remember she died and they tried to work and work and work on her and save her life for so long, and the doctors were saying they should have just brought her into the hospital as fast as they could. So scoop and run's all you could do back then. And usually if we charged, my granddad told me, $5, and rarely collected. So it was, and there were stories, I will tell you, from the 30s and 40s, they'd get an ambulance call and five funeral homes would show up, you know, all wanting to, yeah, get the deal. So that's a true story. So a whole different world back then. I'll tell you that I'm going to have to redo this PowerPoint now that I'm thinking, I need to add some photos. In the 50s, when a mother had her first child, my granddad, they would go and pick her up, drive her home, give her a free ride home from the hospital. Now, when I speak and tell students, I see young girls' faces. I tell them a funeral home ambulance would give them a ride home from the hospital when they have their first baby. You'd think I was Stephen King or something. Their face just can't fathom what that, why, you know? So it's a pretty interesting story. I put this in here because I wanted to give y'all have been to funerals, you know how things have changed, but this is a good juxtaposition of kind of how things were and how they've changed. I'm probably breaking all sorts of copyrights here, but I don't care. I don't hear any audio. Audio? Probably just tip the volume.
Mike, put your fingers in your ears.
Oh, is it going to blast?
That blast or whatever.
I ran it back, so it's not playing right now, in case y'all are wondering.
Thanks so much.
Let me know when you want me to advance it forward again, and I will.
Run forward just a little bit.
Okay.
Still nothing?
Nope. These speakers are connected, y'all have an audio out on your laptop that you can talk to?
It's got a band on that.
Back to my...
The state?
Settings.
I have a speaker, turn it up on the computer. It's not that.
Well, while their techs are looking, anybody have any questions or...
What is the cooling board, what about your net?
Well, it's just, that was just a term, basically, it was just a board, you know, that you could unfold and put either up on chairs or down on the ground, and you would lay the body on, just to perform meetings. Yes, sir.
Mark, I got a question, back in, a long time ago, what was the purpose, and I've heard the older folks in my family talk about this, of setting up with the dad, when they kept them at home, what was the purpose?
You know, I don't know, other than...
Try again?
Well, y'all taking it back to the, I don't know, kind of taking it back to...
Go, there we go.
You'll have to hit play, y'all have control over the, there you go, from beginning up here, you'll want to go to the, okay. I'll fast forward through this real quick.
My dad said that cats would climb the screens, the window screens and the door screens, they wanted to get in, and I think it was just that dead smell would attract animals.
Yeah.
You sure didn't want a rat to get on?
It sounds like that would probably be the beginning of it back in the day. I do know that in the Jewish funeral traditions, that they still have, a person will come to our funeral home, Robertson Muller Harper, and in fact, we have an employee that stays the night in with them every night. That's a tradition that's still carried on to this day in the Jewish tradition.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, well, if you want me to give it a shot?
Now, go ahead.
All right. There you go. Just one perspective. you know, of a traditional white funeral, say in the 50s, maybe different from a home going in the African American community or what have you.
They play that song after.
Oh, in the guards and hoses. And back before that, granddad said at every funeral they'd play Shall We Gather at the River.
They play that in black churches.
Right. And I've been to a few, believe me. And we're very honored to go.
Do you all know that movie Spencer's Mountain?
Yeah.
Glenn Ford and Maureen.
No, Henry Fonda.
Henry Fonda. And that's what, what was the TV show?
Walton.
Walton was based on that.
I chose that just because we're going to fast forward now to see what today's more like. But I love that song, like you later said, played at my grandmother's funeral. And that just kind of encapsulate a tradition of what things were like back then. That old pump organ up on the mountain. And that's the funeral for old man Spencer after a tree fell on him, which happened to a relative in my family back in the 1930s. Tommy knows what I'm talking about. Tree split and fell on him and killed him. And dark time. Yes, sir.
I remember going to a funeral. This was probably in the 80s. But it was out in the country. And, of course, they did not have a musical instrument. But they had one person who was, I think they called him or her, an annunciator. And what they would do is they would say the words to the song, and everybody else would sing it. And as they went through the song, they would say this, 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 and then they would sing it. And then this, 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 and they would sing it. This, 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 and they would sing it all the way through. But I've seen that in a movie somewhere also. But this was actually at a funeral from a very old family in Forestburg, Texas. And but that's the way they did the funerals also back then, when they did not have musical instruments and they did not go through a funeral home and so on and so forth.
And I'm sure that was Hollywood. I doubt many could carry a pump organ up on that mountaintop, right? But it made for a good scene. So we'll fast forward to Denton just a few years ago. I've helped the family. Their grandmother passed away, and she said that one of the sons was in this group called Riders for Jesus, and the motorcycle riders, and she said this is how she wanted to go out. Good comparison to what we just saw. It was powerful service. There were a lot of people came to that graveside, and it was a good day. I mean, there was a lot of spirit there. We'll get to some of the changes that have. This is where my sociologist part comes in. If you'll read that, kind of interesting. There's a little box on the census where you can check if you're affiliated with a church or not. So you can see how it's jumped from 10 to 60 million, check that box, from 80 to 2010. I can only assume that 2020, that'll be up to 80 million. I don't know that. Maybe we'll see a trend where people start getting more connected with churches, but I don't think so, at least not this time. So, as that's changed, so has how people decide what they want to do with the final disposition. In my granddad's 50-year career, he performed, and I'm not making this up, one cremation. And they used to laugh because they didn't even know where the paperwork was. No one did it then, you know, down here. So you can see this, well, this is 2012, we were at 43. Right now, here, that's about right. Up here, we're, our families here, about 50% are choosing cremation. Doesn't mean that they, now if you get into that, then you have to look at the breakdown. How many are just doing that and not having any kind of service? and how many are actually having some kind of gathering and talking about. That's a real interesting statistic there. On the large coastal cities, Los Angeles, Seattle, New York, that is 75% are choosing cremation there. Now, in the rural areas where I talked about, Cisco, Eastland, Comanche, that drops from 50 to about 25%. So I think as you're out in the rural areas and there's more church affiliation, the traditions are slower to change, and you see this is what's happening now.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Okay. You say, is it because of the cost of funerals?
Well, I bet it's got to be a factor.
Or could it be biblical?
I think it's a combination of, you know, our transient population where people are moved. You know, it's not, I'm sure I could ask y'all here if you have kids or grandkids and ask you if they all live in Texas. Do any of y'all relatives that are spread out all over, right?
Yeah.
I think that's an issue. Not being connected to a church, which, you know, we were all taught that cremation was no taboo, you know, not something that we believe in. That's what I was taught.
What does ashes to ashes, dust to dust mean?
Well, I guess it just depends on how fast you want to get to that ashes to ashes. You know, you can do it over time. You can do it in a
group.
I know. I think it's that and cost, too. Because some people, I have buried a couple that were cremated, and then we put both of their urns down in a cemetery plot. So you can do that. Or you can, this is a columbarium, which I tell people that term, we need to get rid of that term because no one's familiar with it. Basically, it's an above ground mausoleum for urns. That's all it is. So,
but it still costs you an awful lot.
The niche, they're calling them a niche. Now, this is out at DFW National Cemetery. You know, if you're a veteran or the spouse of a veteran or a dependent child, then the government pays for your burial. It doesn't pay the funeral home for a service, but it pays for your grave spot or your niche for the urn out there. Yes, sir.
One other thing about cremation is not anything new, because the Native Americans did it throughout the ages.
And the Tibetans, Tibetan sky burial, absolutely. Absolutely. And some people choose to keep an urn at home, so you don't have the cost of the niche, some people will scatter. That's just now I can tell you that people choose to do a lot of different things other than that, too. People now, we sell a lot of jewelry, and my mother has informed us that she's going to be cremated, which sent all the cousins into a tizzy, and they're not happy about it. I said, well, I'm going to, you know, whatever she wants to do. So when that happens, I'm definitely going to take some of her ashes and put them in a necklace or ring or something. A lot of people are doing that, but now they're choosing to do other things. We had a guy who dove hunted with his father. It's his favorite thing to do. So when his father died and had cremated, he loaded all the ashes in the shotgun. I don't know if any of you've ever loaded shotgun shells. I've loaded a lot of shells. So he loaded them in there. So the first dove hunt of the year, he takes the first few dove with his dad with those ashes. And we've had people that have shot them into space, scattered in the ocean. There's a fairly well-to-do attorney in Southlake, I'm not making this up, that approached me a few years ago in an event. He heard about our service, and he said, I'd like to use your family funeral home if I'm going to be cremated. Can you put my ashes in a shell and fire them out of a cannon through a communist flag on my game ranch in San Saba, Texas? Of course, I just looked at him, and I said, yes, we can. So I found the cannon, but the problem is scattering somebody in a cannon is not hard to do. But placing that in a projectile and shooting it. I don't want to kill some neighbor cow 5 miles away or their child. So we're still working that one out.
With my ex-husband would like to have that done, I'm all for it.
Honestly, y'all, we will
pull the trigger. Yes.
We'll border on the illegality. Our real mission is please the family. If the family asks us to do it, we're going to try and do it regardless of the consequences. Yes, sir.
Go to Atlas Fireworks.
Huh? Yeah.
They can do it.
Oh.
They can make you a projectile. That will go through it and explode.
Sure, we can do that. We could. I'm all about it. I mean, you know, nowadays people are doing, they have bagpipers, they have bird releases, butterfly releases. Mainly I like to get, especially if there's multiple generations there, if you've got great-great-grandchildren or great-grandchildren, all these people, is trying to get them to participate somehow, even if it's a cremation, just taking fingerprints of the fingers and putting it on a card and putting it in the urn, or getting to participate in the song, or to do a balloon release somehow, so they have some memory and it's meaningful, a rite of passage to help with that grief and stuff. I personally can't imagine this. I think I would feel this way had I not grown up around this, of letting someone close to me pass away and not have some kind of gathering or memorialization somehow. I mean, elephants do it, giraffes do it, you know, and I would think that we as humans would, but everybody's got their own way. One last thing I want to show y'all, and then it'll be all Q&A. Can you toggle back to the menu? You're going to see a, that says Albert Kane on there.
That's his drive.
Okay. Back to the menu of the little flash drive. I won't be on there.
You're through with it.
There you go. Pearl Harbor, up here, if you'll go to this at the very top, LFH Pearl Harbor. I need to share this with y'all just because it's, you know, we, whoop, can you pause that real quick?
Can you pause all game song.
Can you pause that?
Yeah.
There we go. We honor a lot of veterans. Right, and have since in every, we, my family has fought in every conflict, I mean, that I know of, since the colonial wars. I don't know what went on before that point. And I hadn't found out anybody in World War I. Somehow we just got birth order or something skipped over that one. But they fought in the rest of them. And so, not that a veteran is a better person than anyone else, but they're definitely a solemn thing, especially if someone did give it all and died in combat. And y'all know the World War II generation, that there's not going to be many left soon. And so this is a special, I'll tell you what this is, a gentleman named Albert Kane, Albert Utley Kane, that grew up here in Fort Worth, and his first job was an usher at the New Isis Theater there on near the stockyards. Mm-hmm. He loved film and used to video around Fort Worth and everything, so he joined the Navy. And here is single guy, bachelor in the Navy back in the 1940, early 40s on the USS Oklahoma and Pearl Harbor, and then whammo. Pearl Harbor hits, he gets killed on the USS Oklahoma, like everybody that was on that ship did. So a year and a half later, they raised that ship, and they took all the remains out and buried them in a common grave at the Punch Bowl there in Pearl Harbor. I see some of your nodding your head. And most of the war dead from World War II that died in the Asian theater, whether it was on the island of Tarawa or wherever you were, that's where your remains were sent, laid in a common grave. Same with Korea, Korean War dead. Well, they raided. So a couple years ago, they got the remains out of the USS Oklahoma, out of the common grave, and started trying to identify them with DNA matching. And they matched his remains to a family here in Fort Worth. His parents were gone, his siblings were gone, but his nephew and his nieces were still here. So on this past December the 7th, a couple months ago, we got to lay him to rest at DFW National Cemetery on Pearl Harbor Day within an hour of when he was killed 77 years ago. So that was an honor. So we felt strong enough about it that we hired some videographers and just did this little 3.5 minute piece. So I'll see if I can play this or if we can start it from the beginning or maximize the screen. Oh, there you go.
All gain some. Some gave all. Albert Utley Kane's name will be among the list of those who gave all. Just 1 month shy of his 27th birthday, December the 7th, 1941, he perished as the USS Oklahoma was torpedoed and sank. 77 years to the day of his passing, Pearl Harbor Day, December the 7th, 2018, we celebrate.
Services. I'm a celebrant, is the term being used. So I meet with the family that doesn't have a pastor or a family member, or they don't want it necessarily to be evoked into one religion. And I meet with them and gather all the stories and listen attentively and then try and add some things to it, give some takeaways or mementos that have some meaning to them. And there's a growing trend of that. There's a lot of celebrants around the country that are, so I think you're going to see that evolve too, just as our nation's evolving in so many ways, so is the practice of memorialization as well. And I will say real quick, just so you know, and I don't know how this is going to play out, but with final disposition, not only cremation, now there's alkaline hydrolysis and ecolation, which are not being done here in Texas yet. There's a couple of states up north. Alkaline hydrolysis, you don't have, it's not by flames, it's by chemical that dissolves the body and everything. The ecolation is where the body is frozen and then pulverized and fragmented. I personally, that sort of makes me feel better than the chemical dissolution myself, but it's all, I guess, in keeping with green, Barry, you don't have the flames or the pollution, so the freezing, you don't have the chemicals as well. So that's just to kind of give y'all some heads up on things that are kind of, you know, we'll see trends that are going to be coming down the pike, so to speak.
Well, and then there are the people that want to be frozen, so that maybe
And there are people that don't, you know, used to just donating your body to science meant that you were going to some sort of either a medical school or something of that nature, but there are forensic institutes. There's one in San Marcos with Texas State at their forensic institute. This, people are calling them body farms or body ranches is a slang term, but when you donate your body there, you're laid out in an area that they study, and so people that are studying to be coroners, homicide investigators, study how your body decays so that they can learn to do better forensics. So that's another way to donate your body to science as well as that way. I had a cousin that just did that a couple of years ago. I made a solemn vow to her when she passed that I would pick her up and drive her down there and facilitate that, and I did so. So it was a solemn day. But that's what she wanted, so.
There's also the being put in some kind of concrete thing where they drop you in the ocean to make you a reef for the fish.
Yeah, they do that. Yeah. Or you can, your ashes can be, you know, placed in the base of a tree and a tree grows.
I just did serve a
close friend of mine. Her father passed and her mother's Japanese. He's American. And we cremated him, and she's going to fly him back to Japan. There's a whole forest over there that is nothing but the ashes, so it's like a soul forest. Seems sort of neat to me. I'd like to walk through that if they let you or go see it.
Well, and I saw one where they put them in this egg thing. Their body's all teeny tiny and squished like in an egg.
Huh.
Well, what is the Neptune Society?
The Neptune Society was started by one of our best friends. He sold it to SCI, unfortunately, the large corporate beast. But it's no different than we are. It's just a society that you call if you want to be cremated. And they come and remove your loved one and cremate them and give them back to you. That's all it is. No different than us. Only we own our own crematory, and we're going to pick you up. You're not going to leave our custody. So you're not moving around like you are with some of the places in town I won't mention. Yes,
ma'am. Are there any rules on where you can spread the ashes?
Oh, yeah, there are rules. You're not supposed to do a lot of things, but I can be honest with you.
Don't ask and apologize.
Yep, that's what we tell families. Just quietly, you know, they want to go to the ocean, they want to go to a favorite spot. And it's better just to sort of not say. Now, if you're going to go through a permitting, you can go through it. It's not, but a lot of times you're going to be told no, especially if it's near a national park or near water. So, yes, ma'am.
What happens to those people who don't actually have funds to?
Good question. Well, you live in a benevolent county. Tarrant County actually is a lot better than most. If you don't have any funds, then the family has to fill out an affidavit swearing there are no funds, and then the funeral home has to fill out an affidavit to that effect, that that's what they've been told. And then Tarrant County will pay for your cremation or your burial. It's only, they pay the funeral home $750, I think is what it is. And you're buried at the cemetery south of town.
Laureland.
No, Cedar Hill.
Cedar Hill.
Yeah. And,
an indigent cemetery?
Well, it's not really. They just have a section for that. It's not just an all indigent cemetery. I mean, there are other deserts, but that's what will happen. Now, there is a new something that just, not to start any big controversy, because we didn't get asked or anything. I think just within the last couple of weeks, the county has changed that, and that if they're indigent, they are, from what I understand, I don't want to misspeak, I think they're sending them to UNT, to their Forensic Institute there, and then so I'm not sure what the change is. We're going to have to find out. We just contacted the county commissioners court to ask them what that change is, because if they can't use them, then they're cremating them themselves there. So
they cremate the indigent?
Well, they either use them for science or they cremate the indigent.
Okay. I'm asking for two reasons. I had an experience when I taught government at TC. It was TCJC back in those days.
I remember those days.
Yeah. I had a student who had a heart attack on his job and apparently died without any kin. And they didn't know who to call. And he had one of my business cards in his pocket, and they called me. I had small children at the time, and so I went to him or to the hospital, and it was in Grapevine, and they said, well, we called you, so you need to make funeral arrangements.
Oh. Oh.
And,
yeah.
I don't have to?
No. Well, oh, no, I think you have to, but I'm just saying.
Well, I did. I just called around, and finally I found somebody that would take the body, and they did, and they supplied a funeral, and I didn't have to pay for it. They did it,
yeah.
But I didn't know what happened after then.
You know, after the county, we'll always, we've never said no to that. We'll always do it. Now,
okay.
You're not supposed to, by the county, if they're going to pay for it, you're not supposed to have any kind of service. The county's trying to make sure that people aren't taking advantage of them, that they're not, you know, saying, I don't have money, don't want to pay, and then they're pulled up in a Mercedes. And, you know, we've seen that happen. That's why there's the affidavit process. But for us, when we have an indigent person that doesn't have anybody, we're going to say something, whether the county likes it or not. We're not going to, we just did this last week out of DFW National. There was a veteran that died from the Vietnam era. He wasn't in Vietnam, but he still died, didn't have anybody. No one.
Yeah.
So we found a casket and took him out to DFW National, and I spoke. All that was there were four Veterans Administration people.
Yeah.
Three that hardly knew him, and then one caseworker that had known him for 3.5 years. So I talked about, I found out something about him. His parents died, both of them, when he was 12 years old. Worked in carnivals, then the Army. And, you know, who knows what his life was like. But all I had to go on was what the caseworker told me. So then I read the Serenity Prayer and performed a Christian commitment. So we're not going to let anybody come through our doors if they're poor as Joe's turkey, as Granddad used to say, or if they're a billionaire and not say something on them. Just not going to happen. And I'll tell you, I'm going to sing my cousin's praises, Jim Lucas. For years, perinatal loss, aka miscarriages, were treated as medical waste by most hospitals. He couldn't stand that, so he found some property at Parker Cemetery on 121 on the way to Grapevine that would provide a space. And for years, up until this last year, we didn't charge, I think it's $40 now, the hospital pays. But for years, because of him, we've taken those losses and cremated them free of charge and scattered them at that cemetery, just in a baby area, just because we feel like that's what ought to be done. So there's a lot of unsung, quiet things that we do that we don't go to our horn because we're of service, because that's what we were taught to do. So. Yes, sir.
One thing, or a couple of things I'd like to mention. Number one, my brother was an ambulance driver.
Oh.
He started at Owens Brumley and then he went to Lucas.
Oh.
And so he drove the ambulance along with Jimmy.
All right.
And, but anyway, what I was going to mention is that I went to a relative's funeral a couple of years ago. And when I went, I did not know him, but he was on my maternal side of the family. And so what I did research on genealogy for him, and I did a profile on him along with his family tree. I printed all this out, and I made probably about 10 copies. And I took them to the reception and handed them out at no charge to them. So the people knew his family tree, knew he was related to and how they were related, plus his profile. And as a matter of fact, there was one woman he was married to that nobody knew about. Mm. So anyway, that's what I did for the family, which now they know, because most people only go by surname. They don't realize you've got two sides of your tree.
Right.
And so they know now who he was, plus the rest of the family.
Thank you for doing that for them.
Any other questions? Well, we sure do thank you for coming. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
And it's so good to know that Pima Home has such a history and is so good.
Yeah, I like to say we're kind of like that. National Public Radio has underwriting announcements, and they say, brought to you by Sierra Nevada Brewing Company, family owned, operated, and fought over since 1980. Well, that could be the same set for us, but since 1860. Well, thanks for having me, y'all. It's been a unique experience for me to come back here after doing all these other things and kind of re-immerse myself into how I grew up, but really see, it's just really about helping families, you know, really. I've got to ride a funeral tonight. I'm preaching tomorrow for a nice lady at Robertson Muller Harper. But you learn a lot of neat things from people. I'll tell you one, my cousin probably, I can hear him saying, I don't know if you have to tell that, but I was lucky enough, three men needed someone to preach a service, so they called me and I said, all right, I'll meet with them. Oh, thank you. So I was sitting there asking about their father and everything, and found out, and here I am, just this ne'er-do-well, you know, and their father had flown 33 missions on a B-17 over World War II, over Germany, a famous B-17 called the Scheherazade, which is something from the Arabian Nights tales that named it. And I thought, wow, I'm going to be charged with standing up and telling this guy service flew 33 minutes. And this has happened repeatedly for me over time. So they were talking to me, and this is what I listened for, and they said, well, I don't know if I'd ever tell me about him being a father and how he'd grown up. I don't know if I should really tell this. And I said, oh, what? Tell me. And so they had asked him, they said, Dad, when you were flying those missions over there, did you ever have to use the bathroom? Because, you know, in B-17 back then, you wore like two layers of clothes and a jumpsuit that you had to plug in to stay warm. So he had to go really bad, and he told the boys, he said, I took everything off, and I looked around, and there was nothing to go in but an empty ammo can.
Oh, no.
He said, I pooped in it, flung it out the Bombay door over the Nazis. I told the whole chapel it's the first recorded use of a fecal bomb. And I knew, I thought, I'm going to strike out or hit a home run, and people fell out of the field. That was a good day of telling someone.
Where'd you get your big black hat?
Oh, I rented it from Harris Costume. I'm wearing it Saturday morning because it's the 175th anniversary of the town of Grapevine. So I'm going to dress up in a... My great-great-grandfather really wore, he did wear a frock coat and a string tie, but he really wore more of a round, more cowboy looking. But you know that old, the man who shot Liberty Valance?
Yeah.
Fact or legend, print the legend. Everybody thinks of us in those John Carradine top hats, so I'm going to go with it. Thank y'all. It's nice to be back here in the old cow town.